Alright, hello everyone and welcome to this presentation in which we'll be talking about orbitals in chemistry. We're going to get into where they come from and what they mean. Okay then. So in chemistry, orbitals are used to think, to explain and to calculate molecules. Okay, so naturally I think this gives rise to the question, what is a molecule? Now, the textbook answer here is typically a collection of atoms. So as usual, the question just moves one step back. And then the question is, what's an atom? Okay, so if you Google atomic structure or something like this, you might find, and you're probably already familiar with this kind of representation of an atom. You have this heavy nucleus in the middle, where all the positive charge is located, and then you have the negatively charged electrons sort of whizzing around the nucleus, these fixed orbits, much like planets orbit stars. So I'm here to tell you today that the fact that this is the most common representation of atoms is one of the biggest embarrassments to science of the last century. We've made incredible advances in how we understand the nature of atoms and the behavior of electrons within them. And this picture does not communicate that progress in understanding. Okay, so how might we move towards a better understanding and representation of an atom? So you start with that same positively charged nucleus in the middle. Here I'm just using a very simple nucleus. This could be the hydrogen atom, for example. This would be H+. Right? We've just got a small, heavy, positively charged proton in the middle here. And then the electrons, rather than being on these fixed orbits, are actually better represented by something like this. You have this sort of spread out, delocalized cloud of electron density. It's just, it's mushy, it's fuzzy, it's blurry. This is the most important difference. So in this diagram, each of these dots represents a possible measurement outcome. Every time you ask, where is the electron, you measure, you find a definite position, like one of these dots. However, you repeat that experiment many, many times, and there starts to arise a picture like this. There are more dots in the middle, near the nucleus, near the proton. And the further you go out, there are progressively less and less dots. Until when we're very far from the nucleus, it's very, very unlikely to find the electron. So this is a good representation in the sense that it's kind of accurate to our understanding. We can observe these shapes, these distributions of electrons, but we can also calculate them. And exactly how was known almost a century ago now, in 1927. And it was written down by Schrödinger. And here we see the time-independent Schrödinger equation, which when solved will give us a function that we could represent with this with these dots. But enough about the maths. Chemists are not too concerned with that kind of thing. Instead, we'd like to improve this representation. And one way and we do that is we draw a circle, right? We draw a circle where most of the dots are inside. You might say, what does most mean? And let's just choose something like 80%, but it doesn't really matter. We can always change it later. We draw this circle and we say 80% of the dots, 80% of the electrons, 80% of the electron density is within this circle. So you can spin that around, you make a sphere, and that might look something like this. And now we have an object that represents the shape of the electrons, the shape of the electronic distribution, the shape of, the wave function. and this object is called an orbital, okay? So often then all the dots and stuff, they're actually just quite distracting, even though they're a good representation. And we just work with these surfaces, and we know that they represent you know, the dots and the probabilistic picture, and that most of the dots are inside. So we find that this is actually a really good, really useful representation of electrons in atoms. Okay, so now we know what an atom is. But the question remains, what's a molecule? Well, a collection of atoms. This can start to make a little bit more sense when we look at two atoms. So here we have two hydrogen atoms, and we see below that we could write, for each atom, we can write H dot. So this dot is called a radical. And it just means we have the hydrogen nucleus, which is plus, has a plus one charge, and one electron, which is unpaired and has a negative charge. So overall, we have a neutral atom. We have these two neutral atoms. You know, we write a dot, but you know that it's actually spread out all around evenly, as we see up here. So as we go forward in time here, we see as these two atoms are going to come together. They go through some state in the middle where we draw these dotted lines. These represent partially formed bonds, because these two orbitals are going to meet and they're going to mix together. And as they do that, there will be this awkward point in the middle, and finally a fully formed HH dihydrogen bond. Okay, so let's see what that looks like. Can see that the two hydrogen atoms are approaching each other, the orbital surfaces touch, they mix, they merge, and they form a bond represented by this orbital. Let's have a little look again. Beautiful. All right, this was a nice simple molecule, H2. This is molecular hydrogen, one of the simplest of all molecules. But we often we look at larger, perhaps more complicated molecules, typically based on carbon. So we might look at a molecule something like this. So this is a ball and stick representation. You might have had the pleasure of playing with such a model, not on a computer, but in high school, in class. You have these balls with the holes inside, and you can stick together different bonds and construct molecules like this. And typically, also inside a computer, we stick to this aesthetic because we find it nice and easy and relatable. Now the bonds, the lines between the balls, represent the electrons. And on paper, we might draw something like this, where we have all of the atoms connected by lines. I mean, we might draw single lines or double lines. And we've got these carbon atoms here. Carbon is actually such a common element, and so many molecules are built with a sort of the backbone consisting of carbon, that we often leave out these C letters representing, and we just draw the lines. It's just a little bit cleaner and it's easy, and every chemist knows that carbon is so common that if you don't draw an element, you mean implicitly that a carbon is in that position. So great, we've got this this computer model, and we've got this paper drawing. If we add some colors, we could see something like this. And then all the different bonds, we can actually look at the orbitals that represent the different bonds. For example, here we have this OH bond, this oxygen hydrogen bond, and we can see that's represented by this this orbital here. So in turn, then in blue, we have all these CH bonds, these carbon hydrogen bonds, and we can see them on this side. We can repeat this whole process. Here in green, we have this sort of the main backbone with all the carbon to carbon and carbon to oxygen bonds. And then we notice, something strange here. We in purple, we have these double lines. So what are they going to look like? They have a distinctive shape. They look something like this. It's distinctive because you get part of the orbitals that represent these bonds both above and below the plane of the molecule. And that's so each of these double bonds has a green component and a purple component. It's two bonds between the same two atoms, and we call this a double bond. All right, so chemistry is and always has been a science of change. This comes a little bit from the fact that it emerged out of alchemy, which was fixated with looking for ways to transform common cheap metals like lead into rare expensive metals like gold. And that fixation actually manifests itself today in the way that chemists talk about reactions. And we will see in this slide that orbitals allow us to track chemical transformations. So to go and have a look at the bottom here, we have a molecule. This is known as the chloromethane molecule. That's because we have a carbon here in the middle. There's no carbon drawn, but now you know that one is present. It has three hydrogen atoms, and which are all bonded to the carbon. Now, the bonds with this wedge shape are coming towards you, and the ones with the wedge shaped but then dashed is actually going away from you. So, and this CH3, this arrangement of three hydrogen atoms and a carbon atom is known as a methyl group. And along with the chlorine atom here, we can see that this molecule is appropriately named chloromethane. Okay, so an interesting aspect of the molecule is the carbon chlorine bond. So this is shown in green and is actually represented by this orbital up here. The carbon atom is this gray sphere, the chlorine atom is this green one, and in between them is this orbital, which we draw in this green line, this bond. Okay. On the left-hand side, we have here a fluorine atom. It actually has a negative charge, which is why we draw this negative sign here. So it's not an atom, but what's known as an ion, which is essentially just a charged atom. It has an extra electron, and therefore a negative charge. And we call this a fluoride anion, a negatively charged fluoride. Okay. And we use these arrows to represent change and transformations on paper. So here we draw that this negative charge, represented by this orbital here, is actually going to move in. And we're very visual, very emotive people, chemists. We actually say that this fluoride anion is attacking this carbon center. This causes the electrons in the carbon chlorine bond, CCl, to move out. It's going to pass through this this transition in the middle, this state in which we have a partially formed CF bond and a partially broken CCl bond, until we move to our products, where we have not chloro but fluoromethane and a chloride anion. So we can see that overall the fluoride has basically displaced the chloride. We can represent all of that in the computer, and we can actually calculate and solve it and represent it. So let's have a look and see what that looks like. So the fluoride is moving in, it's attacking the carbon, and if we pause somewhere like this, this represents this awkward state of transition in the middle, where we have this partially formed CF bond in purple, and this partially broken CCl bond in green. We continue and we see that the chlorine bond fully breaks and it dissociates, it moves away from the molecule, and we're just left with our beautiful fluoromethane molecule. All right, so I hope this has given you a little bit of a look into how we actually represent and understand molecules, electrons, orbitals, bonds, and their transformations in chemical reactions. Thank you very much, and see you next time. Ciao.